Does it feel like it's been a long journey to this moment, or was this kind of another step along the way?
It has been a long journey in this, but there were moments along the way, I'm sure, and it felt like it was a long journey. But it seems to have opened up in a very sort of natural kind of way, and I've been lucky, and the steps as they've come have been kind of the right ones. You know, I started off in a recording studio wanting to do record production when I was sort of early 20s. Mm. And that was great because that got me to learn a lot of, you know, the basic stuff, and computers were just coming in there, and I kind of learned how to do a little bit of basic recording into all that. But then the moment when I was getting kind of fed up with that, I saw an advert in the press for a film composer needed an assistant, and then I was into that world, you know, and assisted Trevor Jones for a while and other people. And then just as that was getting, I was wondering what was next. Music editing kind of came along. So there's been little steps along the way.
So is music editing technological, or is that a paper thing?
you're kind of the middleman, basically, between directors and composers, because composers often are great at what they do, but perhaps not great at communication. And directors, there's no reason why directors should have a musical vocabulary, and kind of sometimes they need someone in the middle to kind of help the process, really. And for me, it was, because it was never anything I intended getting into music editing. I always wanted to write, and that was the intention, but getting the opportunity was the tricky thing. So editing was just this opportunity to spend so much time with directors and be really in the thick of it and be in the cutting room throughout the entire process, from the time they start putting the assembly together right through to the last thing in the final mix. So you kind of got a lot of experiences of various musical ways you can help the process and how you.
So are you intensely working in that situation with a sound designer, or?
Not so much. I mean, you come in contact with them at various temp mixes through the process, and that means I'm kind of familiar with their work, and I can kind of have a dialogue with them, and that was great for Gravity, because the combination of sound and music was kind of crucial to the whole sound world working. So you knew these people, and you knew kind of the process, and I'm familiar with dub stages and that kind of thing. But really, it was the great value of music editing for me was this communication thing, and you know, trying to work out what directors really want out of their music, you know, because there's no reason they're going to say, oh, I have a problem with that cadence there, you know. It's not, it's going to come down to, this is moving, this isn't moving, this is, you know, you're hurting my film or you're helping it, really.
So is working with Alfonso in a case like this, I mean, do you have a special musical voice that he was looking for, or is it the fact that you can figure out anything in this situation? What's the connection that makes that work?
I mean, when I first got a meeting with Alfonso, it was a very open thing. They were literally just starting, what's the music going to be? Because we know we're not going to have any sound, so what's the music going to be? And it was a really open conversation about, what do you think the music will be? Because I don't want it to be like, there's no reason it should be a conventional film score. There's no reason why I should have percussion in the action sequences. It makes no sense. It feels like a cheat when you're up in space. So what could it be? And I just started experimenting. And as soon as we started getting into it, we had something to talk about. And then that might lead to another conversation. Oh, perhaps we could try this. And I'd go away and try another couple of ideas and come in and discuss them. So it was a year of experiments and kind of pushing and seeing how far you could take each idea, and then working out how it was helping Sandra's story, basically Ryan's story in the film.
So from the beginning, were you hired? And then
it was kind of a weird thing. There was a 2-week period. Come on for 2 weeks and let's see what happens. And I had this and that was fine, because, you know, Alfonso Cuarón, I love his films. So in you go. But in the meeting, I can remember him saying, you did Attack the Block, right? Yeah, so you're a writer, right? Hope to be, obviously. You know, I do whatever I'm asked to do at this point. And I remember him saying, well, you know, we'll see how it goes. And if it goes well, perhaps you get a couple of cues in the film. You know, you never know how it might. And of course, you know, you sort of tweak something in you. And then 2 weeks turned into about 6, and we did a little test screening with various bits of, you know, my stuff in there. And then I get called into a meeting a couple of weeks after that, and it's like, well, you can't do music editing on this anymore. Oh, okay, well, thanks very much. You know, I'd like you to compose. And that's like, off we go. And then there was another 5 weeks, another screening. And it was just this, we got into these loops of, we've got another screening, we've got to get this amount, let's do something for this bit of the film, let's do something for that bit of the film. And gradually it all built up and evolved and changed over a long time.
So are you intimidated at all in a situation like that, or are you just kind of going
along
with the flow?
Luckily didn't have time. there was always some form of not deadline, but kind of a need to push on with it. It's only recently, really, that I went to the Venice Festival premiere of it and sat and watched, and kind of seeing it in that environment and seeing kind of how music was you know, had this role in it. I was like, God, I should have been terrified, you know. And it was only, and then you had this all that sort of all that feeling came out in one go, and kind of sitting there sort of feeling exhausted. But at the time it was kind of, well, I've got to work out how to do that scene, you know. It was always, there was always something going on, and luckily the work took over from the, I didn't think about it too much, I suppose.
Well, the score feels like it's always kind of, or everything in the film in many ways, it feels like it's always trying to strip back and do less.
Yeah.
And just let the images and the lack of sound do it.
Yeah, it was all there on the screen, really. It was just a case of sort of listening to it almost, and and kind of just being with the characters, and the way that the, it was all there. For me, it was all the way the camera moved suggested certain musical things. The way the weightless feel of it, the way the lack of cuts completely influenced how you write musically, because it takes away the need to kind of suddenly go up a minor third at the end of it, you know, or to do those sort of chapter changes that you'd have in a normal score and use cuts to get things that all of a sudden it became this kind of wide open thing, and you had to find a way to communicate in that space, you know.
So do you feel any urge in the great Mike Giacchino version of Cloverfield, where the, you know, the credits come up at the end, and then the love theme from Cloverfield, massive score, you know, orchestral incredibleness turns up out of nowhere after no music in the movie?
It's, I became very aware early on that if I do anything like that, I would be called on it. It's never. And we did do for the end credits. I remember putting together, because you know we put various versions of things together for the end credits, and we played it, and it just became obvious that no, we shouldn't do that. We should actually do something a bit more interesting here. It seems such a letdown at this point to not do something kind of, you know, immersive and interesting at the end as well, just to kind of finish the whole thing off.
I think people would pay to see the love theme from Gravity.
Sung
by Celine Dion. And,
oh, you know, there you go.
Maybe Celine Dion and Elton John together.
I can't. People would explode. That would, it would be too much.
So do you, Attack the Block was your first full feature composition. So how did that come about? Did somebody?
The thing I did the year before that was a film called Scott Pilgrim vs. the World. Mm-hmm. And I met Edgar Wright for that film. And he was putting it together. So much music in that film. Band stuff and stuff, on-screen stuff. And it was kind of there are lots of score as well. Sort of more score than you kind of think when you're watching it. And lots of interweaving things. And the way Edgar works is very, everything relates to everything else. And there's layers of sound going on. And again, it's an entwined thing. And I got on that and worked with Nigel Godrich on the score, which was amazing, because he's, you know, the finest producer, I think, of this generation. And so that was, I just learned so much from him and working with Edgar. And then, you know, I ended up...
And Edgar's a tough guy. He's
Edgar?
A miserable...
He's no fun at all.
No
very
fun at
hard.
All.
No. He's a dream. And music-wise, he's so into his music. And so it's just, you know, and again, it's ideas. And, oh, let's try this, let's try that. And it was just this great year of trying stuff, and got on very well, and ended up doing quite a lot of arrangements and the orchestra side of it and that kind of thing. And then they had this film called Attack the Block come up, you know, which is obviously a much smaller budget, and music wise they were kind of looking around, and they, same production company, so I got asked to look at it, and it was a great experience.
So again, just another leap forward, just go
That's
for it,
it
and
just
dive
a
in
weird,
and
yeah, and again with that one there was very little time, and it was you know, very little money, and it was a matter of seeing what we could do. And it's, yeah, it just came at a moment, exactly, because after the Scott Pilgrim thing I didn't really want to just edit anymore, because these things are, but you know, bills to pay, so you kind of do, but that came up just at the right time.
And then you did World's End after that.
Well, yeah, World's End actually came after Gravity in the scheme of the timing of these things. But I knew I was doing World's End while I was doing Gravity, and that was after doing the sort of big, sort of intense and the complicated sort of surround stuff of Gravity. Suddenly I had this film where I had all these different films to do within one thing, you know, there was action score stuff, there was quite romantic stuff in some places, and mystery and sci-fi, all in one film. So you got to play with all these other things, and it was kind of this great refreshing rush to play with all those different things. So yeah.
So is there a Stephen Price voice as a composer, do you think?
I kind of know my, and I try and steer away from the things that I do automatically, but they obviously come through. You know, we all have different ways of going from note to note, and it keeps coming out, and there's a theme there. But I hope I can keep sort of finding films that are in different sort of worlds. I find when I was growing up watching films, it was always, I love, and albums, listening to albums, it was the things that sounded weird for the first 5 minutes, and the things that, what's that, and that, do I even like that, you know, and then sort of 10 minutes in you're starting to get used to it, and then 15 minutes in you can't imagine anything sounding different, and it's so belonging to that. And that's the ambition for me, is that you can keep finding ways to give things a unique kind of voice. And it'll still, I'm sure it'll still have my tricks that I kind of try and stop myself doing, you know, and berate myself for, but...
It sounds like you're looking for T-Bone Burnett's career.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's interesting. He's like one of those guys who's a very distinctive character, and at the same time, he kind of embraces the eclecticism of the, you know,
yeah,
of all these different filmmakers, and people kind of just want to hang with him. And
well, and I think it's kind of fascinating just to be with people who are wanting to do something different as well, and are kind of brave enough to do that, you know, and to give you a bit of space to try something different, and kind of understand when you fail a bit, you know, because it means you're sort of pointing at someone and saying, if you can work with those sort of people, they tend to be the most fascinating people on earth. So,
well, I often talk to actors about choices they make or don't make, and they often say, well, you know, you really don't have choices that much unless you're, you know, George
choices
Clooney
or
Sandra Bullock, you know, you're kind of taking work and maybe it's between two things, but you're not like a million choices. Is that how you, and I think the same thing with composers, those almost like composers have their niche.
Yeah.
You know, it's like everybody knows what a Jerry Goldsmith score is going to sound like roughly, you know. Well, do you want to be that? Do you want to not be that? Do you care, really?
I like the idea of trying a lot of things and keeping sort of moving through. I mean, I'd love to do a romantic comedy, you know, after Gravity, it would seem like an unlikely thing. And I know that there is that tendency to go, oh, he does, you know, that sort of film. But I'd love to explore that sort of world and keep trying.
There's not going to be a lot of people going, I need somebody to do what Gravity did.
No, exactly.
As great as it is, it's
fantastic to get your head around something new as well, you know, because the idea of repeating, I like, you know, not particularly repeating myself. So hopefully the opportunities come up, but I have no idea what goes.
So did you never had a game plan, it sounds like.
I knew that I wanted to do what I'm doing now. In terms of what sort of genre, I get excited about stuff really quickly. And even if I sort of hear about something, I go, oh, I'm not sure that's for me. If I start thinking about it, I can soon find a way to get excited about it. And, you know, it's all of a sudden, oh, could I try that? You know, so it's kind of the fun thing to me is something I've not thought of yet. And then I used to love researching stuff. And, you know, the idea of something I know nothing about is exciting to me.
So I wonder where that leaves you. I guess a music comedy, broad comedy, though you... I mean, World's End is pretty broad.
Yeah, but interesting, we played it all completely straight.
In that,
you know, it's funny with comedy. As soon as you try and be amusing, you ruin everything for everybody. So I remember chatting with Edgar at various bits of the World End, and, you know, we were doing, you know, a sad bit. Someone was, one of the characters was thinking back to being bullied as a kid and stuff. And we played it so sadly, so sincerely sadly. There wasn't a moment of sarcasm in it, and it's like you actually don't get to do that very often, you know. It's only the fact it was a comedy that allowed you to be honest. It was weird.
Well, I think one of the rare other times which I still remember to this day, sitting in a theater and watching, is the Santa suit sequence in Gremlins. Phoebe Gates talks about her father dying in the chimney, pretending to be Santa, and did it completely straight.
Absolutely,
it was such a horrible story, but so funny.
Yeah, exactly. And if it had been amusing music, you'd assume hated every second. Exactly.
You don't want any of that.
Yeah, no sort of stuck chimney noises. Exactly.
So you're out here now, and you're meandering around with composers and going to events with composers and all that.
Yeah.
Does it feel like you're joining a new fraternity or something? Or
it's lovely, and it's surreal, really. You know, I there's been a couple of notes from people that I greatly, greatly respect and admire, and you kind of go, oh, that's okay. The idea you've even seen this is kind of remarkable to me. So it just feels like a few doors have opened, and it feels very welcoming, actually. It's kind of, I've been happy to sort of see it, and here as well, because the film's not out in the UK.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of whilst I'm aware things are going on, it's a very different world, you know, so you hear of it going quite well. But then you come out here and you realise that the film's kind of connected with people. So
there's all of the energy that, I mean, because obviously Gravity's had this huge kind of giant footprint this last month here.
Yeah.
Do you feel it in England? I mean, are people in there going now clamoring for the movie to open there?
There's definitely kind of, it was just starting to ramp up. I mean, I left at the end of last week, and the advertising campaigns are starting to ramp up, and people know about it, and there's been print interviews from Venice and all that kind of thing. So there's an expectation. Obviously, people know what it's done over here. So I'm looking forward to it coming out at home so my friends can see it.
We're such media whores over here that I feel like we infiltrate every country. And
I've been following it vividly, as you can imagine, and sort of making sure I've checked in on it. So it'd be fun seeing it coming out at home.
So was there much research involved with this particular project?
Only kind of, you know, I got into the the story of it, and you know, this whole thing of the debris, and I just find that sort of stuff fascinating anyway. Mm. And we all looked, I know the sound guys looked into the physics of it, and that, you know, this whole sound thing, but for me it was kind of it was finding a way to kind of help this sound world, and you know, the idea that we weren't going to have explosions, but you kind of needed to feel something, and you needed to make that inherent in the music. That was the big challenge for me, kind of making things that might have been sound design in another world, making them musical, but making them not feel kind of comedically musical, making them feel like they belonged. And it's, you know, lots of challenges with this one, with how we were going to do it and how we were going to make it immersive and how we were going to, because, you know, the screen's always going to be in front of you, not all around you, but somehow with the music, we were trying to make it feel like you were up there and you're kind of like a third astronaut. And so the music was designed to move around and to continually kind of move around with you, and the camera, if there's a POV shot, the music might move behind you, so you kind of, hopefully you don't realize that's what's happening, but the music's kind of orientating you around with the camera a lot of the time.
So does the thinking on that come from you, since you have experience doing that, or is that a combination of that and the sound designer, or?
It was, Alfonso was kind of pushing for that all the way along, and it kind of, a lot of that was the music stuff, but we would have a lot of meetings along the way where I'd kind of play. I kept the sound crew in the loop all the time with what I was doing, and kind of, they knew where it was all going to fit together. And then we'd get to these mixes together, and I would attend the tent mixes on this, which is kind of unusual, but because of my background, it kind of made sense to be around. And so we'd kind of work on it together and work out how to make the moments work. You know, when you're going into a helmet, sort of how can we make it that feel like you're in there with her, and then sort of how, you know, it's all these. And lots of it was just trying stuff until they felt right, you know.
So seeing this movie with good sound is a really good idea.
I certainly, the Atmos mix that we did, the last thing that we did in the film was this thing in Dolby Atmos, which, you know, amazing kind of stuff. And that for me felt like the finishing touches of the project. We got to, with 7.1, it was great fun and we got everything moving around, but it's kind of, you can't quite pinpoint exactly where you wanted to be, and all of a sudden you could pinpoint it, and you could tweak this stuff forever. I think all of us would happily have, you know, done a bit more if you could, and you just keep going forever.
Well, it's funny because I the experience that I keep on touting is going to the what is now the IMAX at the Chinese theater.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And yet they don't have Atmos because there's a legal conflict with the
I never knew that.
Kodak.
Until we were in LA doing this Atmos mix, and someone said to me, oh, do you want to come through and hear the IMAX mix? I was like, oh, this is going to be good, you know. And then they revealed there's four speakers.
Yeah.
Apparently I've not seen it in IMAX, but apparently it still plays very nicely and all that.
It was fantastic, but it's like, it's just kind of...
You'd wish that they'd get
it. You kind of want to have it all.
Yeah.
You want every part of the experience.
The full visual thing and the Atmos thing. Yeah. Surely someone should arrange that at some point.
Maybe in a Disney park.
Yeah, there you go.
I believe
in China there's some sort of slight sort of systems which aren't quite official, which may get the best of all worlds.
There are Chinese knockoffs of Atmos already?
Possibly.
I don't know what you're talking about. What's interesting thing is sound is kind of coming back as a thing people care about.
Yeah, which is great, because I mean, certainly in England, you know, for a long, long time, it was you'd go to the theatre and there may not be a speaker plugged in or something, and it would be slightly underwhelming. And that, I think the whole thing of cinema experience is that's a great thing about Gravity going down well. I think is people are going for this experience. Yeah. I remember we talked when we were mixing the film, you know, where if you, certainly in the Atmos mix, but even in the 7.1 mix. Where you sit in the theatre, you're going to have a slightly different experience of how things shift around. And that's kind of an interesting thing, that each experience of this film is different depending on where you see it, you know?
Well, it's interesting because film critics, I think, are trying to separate the idea of the experience versus a movie.
Yeah.
And in some ways, I mean, a great movie is an experience. I mean, it's inherent in both directions.
Yeah.
You don't have to be a carnival ride.
Yes.
Because I don't think Gravity is. I think it's much more emotional than that. I think that's why it works so well.
Yeah, I hope so. And certainly the journey for me and Ryan's journey and the performance, I think there's it says a lot to me. You know, as I was working on it, I was always very aware that there was a very strong core of growth and rebirth through this thing that to bring out. And I think the fact it's a cinematic experience is something to be applauded, hopefully.
So did you have footage that was reasonably close to what it might look like through much of this?
I was putting together I'm doing something for the Blu-ray, you know, where they do a little feature on the making of kind of thing, and I got my old drive out to get some stems up of things, you know, all this, because we had so many elements going on and things flying around, and I got it up and I got the picture up, and the picture that I recorded to, you know, and this was the thing that we've showed at Abbey Road and all that, And I hadn't realized just how much things had changed since that stage, you know, because it never struck me, but, you know, beautiful shot, suddenly a polygon, you know, and it was all there, it just wasn't kind of colored in yet, you know, but so yeah, I remember seeing it in July of this year when we did that Atmos thing, and it's the first time I'd seen finished visuals. Mm-hmm. And there were little moments, you know, there's a moment where there's a tear, you know, and that I knew the tear was there, but suddenly there was this detail within the tear and the reflections within it, and that seemed to do something with it. There was a musical thing that was in there that it went across, and they shimmered, and the shimmering, and it was kind of this, that's what suddenly raised it up a level. The visual work was amazing, I think.
So did you change anything because of that?
Or? There's a couple of tiny little tweaks and things that you kind of would just levels things, nothing particularly structural, but just, you know, if you could get a little 10% out of something else or 2% out of something else, we might tweak it. Yeah.
So when did you see it all put together for the first time?
That Venice? Was Venice, yeah. The first time I saw it was in Venice. And there were kind of technical woes with that screening, which it didn't seem to affect how it went down, but there was a bit of a thing with the 3D at the start and all this. So it wasn't the most relaxed. And then a couple of weeks after that, there was a screening of Friends and Family thing, which was in London, Dolby Atmos thing. And it's the first time I took my wife to see the film. She'd not seen a frame of it, you know. And that was great, because that was a glorious picture, and also the sound was exactly as we'd finished it. Mm-hmm. And I got to see someone's reaction to it, you know, and there were various partners of people around as well. And that was the time I saw it kind of finished, and yeah. And I was surprised how even the people who worked on it, you know, I was there, and Tim Weber and people like that did the visuals. And kind of we started watching it as a film after a while, because everyone's elements had kind of gone up since we'd last seen it, you know. So that was encouraging.
Well, it does seem like it was very, like, everybody was either completely focused on every minute detail, or they were really, you know, like Sandra talks about not knowing what was really going on. You know,
well, she was doing a performance. That they, at Venice, that was the first time they'd heard anything with music on it or anything like that. It was whole thing was new to them, so... Yeah, which they luckily I think they liked. It could have been an embarrassing after party otherwise.
So can you tell how the audience is reacting to your music in a movie like that?
Not to specifically the music, but to the experience. You could hear the tension. You could see the people kind of gripped. And it's we did a lot of work with kind of the tempos of things and trying to reflect tempos. If someone's getting anxious and the heart rate goes up, the kind of the music rate would go up and the pulsations in the music would do that, and sometimes there's an actual sort of sound design heartbeat that's in there, and other times music does it. And you could kind of hear people's breath kind of shortening at times, and you know, little moments, and the sort of the shock moments seem to get the leaps and that kind of thing. So you kind of, regardless of I mean, hopefully people don't necessarily think about the music as they're watching it, they're more sort of immersed in the whole thing, but you're kind of aware that it was having some of the effect that you hoped it would have.
So what do you make of Alfonso? Obviously he has a great deal of talent and skill, and craft, but is he just willing to go places that other people aren't necessarily willing to go? Is he fearless?
I think not just willing, determined to push it as far as it could ever go. And the thing for me was, you know, if you've even had the slightest thought about something that might work, go do it and push it as far as it can go, and go too far and realize you've gone too far, and then come back. But unless you've really gone with it, don't bother. You know, it's everything. There might be something around that corner, so you always have to go to that corner, and you do that complete until you run out of time, and there's until that moment, and then you go, okay, we gave it our all, and it was always that all the way along. And he was incredibly supportive of that sort of thing. And you know, there must have been times when I bought something in that, you know, I pushed it as far as I could push it, and I really should have stopped a lot earlier. But the support of that act of doing that.
Right.
And all these things, you know, even the failed experiments led to, well, that didn't work, but perhaps we should try this. And that would then you'd go off and try and work out a different plan, you know. How about an instrument that sounds like a radio tuning, but then suddenly becomes the tune, but then you don't really realize, because then it becomes the radio thing, and you get all excited, and then go home and go, how am I going to even do that? And then you start, you know, making an instrument, or, you know.
So you had these conversations with directors before, or is this just...
Not these sort of... I mean, some of them were incredibly abstract conversations, and I love all that as well, you know. I love a bit of theorizing and a little bit of conceptual business, and, you know, I got obsessed with, you know, things with the tethers and things like that, you know. The movement of the tether and the way that the people would come across, and then they would pull together, And somehow we found ourselves talking about tape loop experiments back in the 60s, you know, Steve Reich things of tape phase and all that. And so I would go back and I could do a computer version of that. You know, nowadays you could make, you could control that and, you know, use the random, but also make it... And in the film, that's in there and it's buried away, but it was, you know, you'd never hear it like that. But all these, some of the conversations we had would just lead you off in a direction that, yeah, you'd certainly, you weren't talking in terms of, oh, I want something a bit like in that film, you know?
Right.
It was all very kind of conceptual stuff about what you were trying to do. And it, but it all came down to, was it getting you in the gut, really? And if Alfonso has this amazing ability to see things fresh each time he sees, you know, usually if you're working on a bit of music or something, you get used to it, right? And all of it, and then you start, you know, finessing. But essentially that first impact has gone, you know, whereas he seems to be able to keep that fresh emotional impact. He responds to it as if for the first time. So that's great, because you don't kind of, and you might go through a lot of versions of something and then this isn't working now. But that's great, because you don't settle.
So his brain injury works for him.
Sorry?
His brain injury works for him.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Absolutely.
His complete lack of memory beyond short term.
Yeah, yeah.
Is brilliant and all that.
Absolutely.
Things.
It's a creative boon. Yeah.
So after all that tinkering and figuring, I mean, it sounds like it was fantastic and fun, really. Mm. Do you feel like going, you know, the full Rachmaninoff and just banging on a piano for a movie? Or?
Exactly. just doing one thing with one instrument, yeah. Yeah, that would be... absolutely, but it was like the World's End was great for that, because then you came out and I got the, you know, drum kits out and loud guitars and things like that, and let strings be strings for a little while and brass be brass, because the Gravity, it was always this, you know, you can have an orchestra but I don't want it to sound like an orchestra, you know, and get your head around how to use what it can do in a different way. So it was nice to...
So how big was the biggest orchestra you had on Gravity?
It was always separate. I never kind of had everyone in a room, because with everything moving about sort of within the theatre, you had to get it all separate. We had 48 strings was, I think, the biggest string group we had.
And so
we
the strings really were the...
Yeah, strings were the sort of biggest thing. And that was only for a few sections of the film, like the sort of the end stuff and a few of the emotional moments, there was bigger stuff. But a lot of what it was small groups or sections divided, so that I would, you know, have one string line that I'd record, and then I'd get the complementary string line, and perhaps we'd move them around, and they would twirl about each other, you know, to follow the characters' movements and that sort of thing. So it was a lot of small stuff rather than big Hollywood kind of uber orchestras, you know.
So was this the thing that you were, not the thing, but is this life that you're now living the last few years and these last few movies, the life you were thinking about when you were, you know, 19 years old, and you were...
Oh God, yeah. I said, well, actually, not 19. When I was kind of going through college and all that sort of stuff, it was records. I was convinced it was records, and it wasn't until I got my first job working for a composer, and he left me to sort of work out the gear for an afternoon. So like, go in there, you know, I'm busy, sort of going, dude, I've got this bit of film here, just, you know, see what you can do, sort of thing. And I remember just you know, I played something in. And just being able to move a note. And I started moving, and I spent an afternoon doing it, and I probably annoyed him no end because I achieved very little. But just moving a note and sort of the idea that you kind of change from the C to the D or whatever it was, either on the blink, slightly after the blink, but and how it changed everything about that moment. And I just remember saying, oh, this is interesting and this is fascinating, and you can, very small gestures can do incredibly big things. And I kind of, yeah, light went on, and from then it was always about this, and kind of just trying to work out a way to get to it, you know, and luckily I kind of enjoy all these other roles I've done, so it's not been a trial to go through the ranks, basically. It's been fun, but it's taken a long time to...
But Alfonso and Edgar are a pretty good kickoff.
Yeah.
I've been incredibly fortunate
to work, yeah, and Joe Cornish as well, he did a tackle block, you know, sort of all... clever people who love music, which you can't really, you know, hope for more, really, film-wise.
And you get the secret power of the composer.
The secret power.
Well, people don't realize how powerful the composer, you know, the composer really runs the show. It's really movies about the composer, pretty much.
Clearly, although I once had a conversation with someone who said music is one of the few things that can really break a film. So, you know, it works both ways. You can really screw up doing music.